possibly imagine what you're excited about. Well, listen, thank you very much for your patience, all of you. Great to see an audience. A very special welcome to our guests this afternoon, our guests, I should say. We have Polly Billington, who is our prospective Labour Party candidate. Other candidates are available, and we have invited the other parties in. So before I get any complaints, we have invited Jackie Dolprice and Tim Aker in. So you know, we're open to all politicians to help you, and the most important thing is that you turn out and vote. We're not trying to tell you who to vote for, just to get out there and vote. A very, very warm Palmer's welcome to our special guest, Dr. Brian May. PhD astrophysicist. By the way, we have Dr. Matt Taylor in, the project director for the Rosetta mission. Yes. So all we need is Brian Cox, and we've got the hat trick. But Brian is also very committed to animal welfare. Any of you that are involved in Badger Watch will know. And I think, you know, that in my book makes him all round good bloke. Now, if I may say so. I'm going to shut up because you really don't want to hear me. It's Brian May you want to hear.
I had no idea what I was walking into. It's a fantastic reception. Thanks so much. But first of all, packing the place and being here. Thank you for that lovely noise you make. It's incredible. So I feel very welcome. Why am I here? To meet you guys, to talk about the election and life and stuff. And I'm here to support this lady, Polly, who I believe is a thoroughly decent person and deserves to be elected. So I make no bones about that. I mean, I will be asking you to vote, but I will be asking you to vote for her in this particular place. So we'll start with that, okay? I'm wearing a common decency badge, as you can see, which is very much like a prefect's badge. This is not by accident. what we're doing is, and we have lots of badges by the way afterwards if you're interested, the reason that I came to this common decency thing is because I spent the last 5 years around Parliament, Paul Collis House, lobbying as an activist, if you like, to try and give animals a voice, I was so shocked in 2010 when I discovered that David Cameron was about to try to bring back blood sports. So we're talking about ripping foxes apart with packs of dogs, also stags, hair coursing, all these other bloody things which probably should never have survived even into this century, along with burning witches at the stake and bear baiting and all the other hideous things that people do. I was so shocked that this was on the agenda, this was actually in the manifesto, and still is, by the way, that we started a thing called Save Me, which is all about trying to give animals a voice, wild animals in particular. So our thing is foxes and badgers. Badgers also because badgers have been culled over the last 5 years in ostensibly to control a disease called bovine TB in cattle. Now, the fact that all the scientific evidence tells us that culling badgers, killing badgers, is not going to solve the problem, and indeed it may make the problem worse, has made no difference. So I guess what I'm looking at, in my opinion, is a government that doesn't look at the evidence and must have other agendas. Why are they culling badges? I look at other things. I mean, I look at all sorts of things which ought to be in place and aren't. For instance, I look and I see why, when a 16-year-old can have a family and can go to war and various other things, why can't a 16-year-old vote? Anybody think that's a good idea, that they shouldn't be able to vote at 16? I don't know. I'm wondering. I mean, to me it's a no-brainer that they should have a vote, and the reason why that hasn't even been on anybody's agenda is because in a two-party system, it's been shown to these people that probably it wouldn't be a good idea for them. So you're looking at a Conservative Prime Minister who's been told that if he allows votes for 16-year-olds, he might lose his seat, so it becomes a self-interest thing. Proportional representation. We have a system at the moment, which is going to happen on May the 7th, called First Past the Post, So we may have a situation where one party gets something like 15% of the overall votes nationally, but they would get 1% of the seats in Parliament. Now, to me, that is such a no-brainer that it's unjust. It hardly bears talking about. But we don't have proportional representation. Why? Because, again, a major party in power will be told that it won't benefit them. So they will find all sorts of reasons to tell us that proportional representation can't be done. They actually told us when it came to the referendum a few years ago that it would be too complicated, and they managed to persuade us that that was the case, or they managed to persuade the majority of the electorate. So that's another example to me of democracy not working. You've seen lots of MPs pulled up for fiddling their expenses recently. That's not democracy working. We've seen people who have been shown up for voting on issues in which they have a financial interest, like fracking or whatever. That's not democracy. So we start from animals. This is me and my CEO in Save Me, and Brahma. We've been in there looking and trying to fight for animals, but we realize that people who are fighting for any kind of decency come up against the same brick wall. If it's not advantageous for the party in power to make some particular change, then it won't happen. It won't happen because it will eventually come to a vote, and the vote will be controlled by the whips. So even if perhaps you have some MPs who have, for instance, been helping us with the badges, they'll find that they can't vote with us on a vote on a badger cull because the whips will come down on them. The whips will take away their privileges. Maybe they won't be able to see their kids that weekend or something. Most people don't realize that this goes on, but this is our democracy, and this is the way our voice has been eroded. I would tell you, as a person who's tried to change things for the better in Britain, that there is no way that a voice can be heard and can make a difference. You can all go on marches, you can go on the government website and sign a petition. It says at the top, if you get 100,000 votes, you get a debate in the House of Commons. We did that, and we actually got 300,000 votes, signatures on our petition to stop the badger cull. So we got our debate, and we thought, oh, whoopee, democracy actually works, how amazing. We have the debate, we have the vote, we won the vote. And what happened? Nothing happened. We got a kind of smirk from the Minister of the Environment saying, you know, yeah, okay, you won the vote, but it makes no difference. We're going to do exactly what we want to do. So what I'm saying to you is you have 15 hours every 5 years to make your voice heard, to cast your vote. And if you don't use that, then everything's going to be the same as it was for the last 5 years and the 5 years beyond that. So I'm here to say vote. Now, in this particular situation, you have a constituency here which is not a safe seat. It's a seat which is very much in dispute. So there's no question that every single vote will count here. I don't know if I can show you a pie chart. I love my pie chart. Oh, I think we've been short on pie chart. I think we've lost some. Oh dear. Well, here's a tip. I mean, I do find that talking about figures, it's hard because we can't take figures in, but we can all take pictures in very easily. This, strangely enough, I'm going to show you because this is the worst case. This is actually where I come from. It's my fabulous town of Feltham in Middlesex. Very glamorous. And this is what happened last time. This person won. Now, ignore the colours. I'm going to say I'm colourblind because really what I've found over the last few years is, yes, there's a lot of opposition to common decency in the House of Commons, but there's a lot of good people, and there are good people in all the parties. So we're supporting various candidates that we think are decent from all parties. So ignore the colours on here, except that they tell you that there's different sectors here. This guy won last time. This guy was second, and these guys are small things. So if you're in this constituency, you might think, well, this is looking a bit safe. It's going to be hard to change that. But if you look at all this is all the people who didn't vote in my hometown of Feltham last time. Incredible that all those people decided it wasn't worthwhile to vote. If all these people get off their arse this time and vote, anything can happen. So normally I'm speaking in safe seats, and I'm saying to people, it will happen. You know, if you go to vote, be advised by us, and actually we can all make a difference if we mobilise this, which is us. This is the people who are thinking, you know, should I really bother to vote? Now in this constituency, you know you have to vote because it's going to be a tight race. And I believe that we need a House of Commons full of people who will do what they say they will do. They haven't been levered in for some party political aim. Here you have a person who lives in this community, works in this community and has already done a lot of good for this community. She's also lived in the political arena because she's worked with Ed Miliband for a long time. And the people that she's worked with, we have worked with, we come to support her knowing that she comes from a good place and knowing that she will go into the House of Parliament and she will speak her mind. She won't be afraid to speak her mind. It can be hard. You can get bullied in the House of Commons, and it happens a lot through the whip system and through the general sort of carrot and whip situation that goes on. But we know that she will fight. Firstly, I know that she will fight for animals, which is a big thing for me. Secondly, I know that she will fulfill her promise of serving the community because she lives in this community. She understands it. She hasn't been parachuted in from someplace else. And also, she will be accountable. She will talk to you and check that you approve of what she's doing. She's a person of conscience. If it comes to it, she will vote according to how she feels morally things should be. I have a problem. I've been on a sort of campaign tour and a lot of media and stuff, and I find that everybody wants to talk about money the whole time. Now, money's important, of course. We all have to grow up. All of you will have families to feed soon, so you have to think about money. But basically, I feel that there is a lot more to life than money. There's a lot more to being a human being than just earning something and being richer than the next man. I think a lot of us who are impassioned and have something that we are desperate to create will make money along the way. That's a lot different from being someone who's obsessed with just making money. That's my view. So I believe that you should vote according to how you feel conscience-wise. As I say, I'm here because of this lady and I believe in her, so I'm hoping that all of you will use your vote, use your voice. But more than that, anybody here not registered? No, I shouldn't say that. Who's registered to vote? Yeah, it's looking good. Okay, that's good. I'm not going to ask who didn't, because it's too embarrassing. Please vote on May the 7th. Do get out there and do it. I take it because you've registered, you want to do it, that's great. But also use your social media. This is a different election from anyone previously. There was never an election in which there was such a power in social media. You can all tweet to all your friends. You can tweet to people that you know up and down the country who've gone to different universities. You can do Facebook or whatever. And you can spread the word like wildfire. So this is the first election where ideas can spread that fast. You can get the idea in your head that it's really important to vote, and you can motivate some people to vote in places where it's not a foregone conclusion that it will count. So you can vote, you can urge people to vote in a place where perhaps they're thinking, oh, this is a safe seat, I'm not going to vote. Get on Twitter, get on Facebook and say, look, do vote, and do vote according to, well, at least look at what Common Decency has to say. commondecency.org.uk is our website. On this website, you'll find lots of these pie charts for all the different constituents, 650 constituencies all around the country. So ask all your mates to look at Common Decency and see if we have something worthwhile to say. And our plan is to be a swarm and to get the good people into Parliament, to save the good ones, kick out the people who are arrogant and don't bother to vote or don't bother to learn what the vote is about. I have to tell you, I've seen some things which would shock you in the House of Commons. I've seen debates where there's a couple of dozen people who are lucky in their voting an issue. The division bell goes, and all these people rushing, oh, what's all this about? What should I vote? They've been in the bar, they've been in the restaurant, whatever. They come and they vote according to what the whip tells them. That's our democracy. That's what I want to shake up. I want to get people in there who care. And I believe this lady is one of them. But please join Common Decency. See, I'm being very unashamedly pushy here. But look at Common Decency and see if you can get all your friends into it and get them to get all their friends on it, because we can be a kind of snowstorm and we can clean up this country, I believe. That's the end of my speech politically. That's the end. Expect me to come on so strong to you, but you know, I'd love to take questions, and you can ask me anything you like. It doesn't have to be about the very serious business of the election, because you know, I'm a human being. I care about art and science. I care about people's interactions, you know, and politics is something which to me is relatively new in my life. I spent a lot of my life just thinking other people can do it. Now I don't think that. I got to the point where I'd achieved a lot of my dreams, and I thought, I can make a difference now. I can actually, and I should get back in there. because there are things to be done in this country. I'm not saying we're the worst country in the world, but you know, as a democracy, which is supposed to be the shining light around the world, we're in pretty poor shape, I believe. So you guys are the future. I hope you'll all kind of take up this issue. And while you're raising your families, and while you're pursuing your careers, have a think about the rest of the people in this country, you know, the poor people, the disadvantaged people, the sick people. Have a think about the animals in this country who are being squeezed out, and try and bear it in mind, and maybe one day you'll be doing what I'm doing, going out there and beating on the doors of people who really don't give a shit. Okay. So, can we take questions?
Yeah, of course
we can. Oh, we have many questions, right, well, oh, sir. Who put up a hand there, sir?
I debuted.
I was just pulling his hat down.
What is it that brought me passion for animals?
Sorry?
What is it that brought me passion for animals?
What is it that makes me have that passion for animals? I come from the point of view of an astronomer. You know, I was brought up in science more than I was brought up in anything else, and I returned 30 years later to get a PhD, so I am a proper doctor of astrophysics as opposed to an honorary doctor. So, astronomy will tell you, the history of astronomy will tell you, that for 2,000 years after Ptolemy until now, or until the middle of the 19th century, people thought that the Earth was at the center of the universe. And it was assumed that everything else goes around us. And when it was discovered that we're not, there was a terrible ruckus. You know, people were really upset to find that we weren't the center of the universe. Nevertheless, everybody's got used to it now, post Copernicus and Galileo. They got persecuted for saying that at the time. Now we know that the Earth isn't at the center of the universe, but we still have this idea that humans are somehow the center of creation. Now, to me, there is no evidence for that. I don't see why people would take it into their heads to think that we, human beings as a species, are more important than any of the other species. We're all at the pinnacle of evolution, if you like, if you believe in evolution. So I'm tempted to say I hope you do, because if I was speaking in Ohio, I'd probably be arrested at this point. But if you believe in evolution, you look at all the animals who survived to the present time, and you'll see that, you know, we're all the result of evolution. We're all kind of perfect creatures, in a sense, because we've adapted to the environment we're in. Why would we assume that we, as a species, are so vitally important just because we can build roads, because we can cover the world with concrete? Why would we assume that all the rest of the creatures are just to be used or eaten or abused or got rid of if they're in the way? So to me, it's kind of a fundamental tenet of mine that all creatures matter. Not just all species, but all individuals. So if I see an animal suffering, I get very angry, and I think, why is that happening? If I see a child suffering, I get angry. Why would that happen? So to me, we have an obligation to be decent and compassionate towards every creature on this planet. So that when I look around me, I see that that's very much not the case. Animals are getting abused all over the place. And I've always felt that it's wrong. So having, you know, achieved some success, made some money, achieved a lot of my dreams, I thought it's time for me to try to make that difference for animals. And that's still why I'm here, really. You know, the animals are really the driving force. And we have an awful long way to go, I think. Does that make sense? Ma'am.
Why do you think that proportional representation is a good idea when it fell in Germany before the World War?
I don't know if it failed in Germany, because in a sense it gave people what they wanted at that time. I don't know if not having proportional representation would have made a difference in that instance. Okay, I'm probably not qualified to answer that. Why do I think it's not right? Because how can it be fair for a certain proportion of the country to vote for small people, but for that to have no effect? And also to vote for medium-sized parties, and that to have very little effect. I don't know quite how many people. I think most of the people I know kind of want to vote green, to be honest, where I come from, because they think, you know, that's the only really, you know, decent option where they are. They probably won't vote green because they think it's impossible for that candidate to get in where they are. But in a proportional representation of some kind, they could cast their vote and it would make a difference. Right now it doesn't. I'm not quite sure what percentage the Greens got in the last election. I think it's like 10% or something, I'm guessing. But they got 0.01% of the seats. They got one seat out of 600. No, that's wrong, isn't it? They got one seat out of 650, which is a lot less than 1%. So to me, that's not fair. That's not making the representatives in the House truly representative of the people's will. So to me, some kind of proportional representation needs to come in. It's never going to come in while you've got one major party bullying everybody else, because proportional representation does not benefit them. The system as it is at the moment benefits the big parties. So to achieve democracy, I think you have to, I would love to see, on after May the 7th, a House which was more evenly divided, where the whips couldn't push, couldn't bully a policy through against the will of the majority. So that everything would have to be debated. That's what Parliament was put there for. Parliament was there to have people reasonably debate and come to some kind of compromise, and then the policy would go forward. Strangely enough, Germany is a good example now, because they have a strong Green Party. They have a fairly even distribution of power in their House of Representatives. And what happens is things move rather more slowly. So if they want to build a motorway, it takes quite a while, because a lot of discussion has to take place. But you don't get one party would build it and one party wouldn't build it. What you get is, okay, we'll build it, but we'll make sure there's corridors for wildlife. We'll make sure we take care of the people whose lives are threatened by the motorway going through their living space. So you get a situation which I think works a lot better. It might slow things down, but at least you get decisions which are made considering everybody, not ploughing through one section of the community's views. So I would like to see something a lot more like Germany today in our House of Commons. I'm not hearing you. If I was to take...
If they were to vote for you and...
Oh, you see, but I'm not standing for Parliament, you know, I'm not a political party.
You personally, what
would I do?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, I think it's a question of how fast you would go. I mean, just supposing we had a Green Prime Minister, yeah, I think things would have to change very, very, very fast. And you'd have to do it bit by bit. I mean, personally, I'm a vegetarian. I did eat animals a lot of my life, but I came to the conclusion that I wouldn't. You know, as part of what I'm doing now. I'm not quite a vegan yet. I think I would like to be, and probably I will be in the future. It's just I think it's a line you move along. I would love to move to a situation where we don't abuse animals in any area whatsoever. So we are wild animals. I would like to see, for a start, an end of hunting for pleasure. I cannot see that's justifiable, you know, in a decent society, going out and shooting, whether it's birds or whether it's chasing after foxes or this awful hair-coursing thing that they do. I would personally get rid of all that. I would make it unlawful to torture an animal for fun. That would be first. I would stop people experimenting on animals and causing them pain as well. I'm not convinced that it's necessary anymore. I'm a member of Frame, and Frame is able to replace all the experiments that are done on animals by other means, by in vitro or computer research or whatever. So I would stop experimentation on animals. I would like to move towards us not eating animals. I don't think you can force people, but I think it will happen in the end. And at the moment, I think we're quite close to a breakthrough where something that's very similar to meat can be made without killing an animal. As soon as you make it so that it tastes as good or better than a piece of steak, you're almost there. As soon as you make it cheaper than a piece of steak, then it's done, because society is about money, and a lot of people can't afford to be choosy, you know. So I believe you can probably replace meat in the next 50 years or so with something which doesn't involve cruelty. I think all of us, if we visited an abattoir, would stop eating meat, because it's so hideous. And it's so awful to see how these animals are treated. It's a horror story. It's Auschwitz, you know. And if you're interested in that stuff, look on my website, because Gary Yourofsky talks about this stuff very convincingly. It's hard to sit through a Gary Yourofsky lecture without thinking, oh my God, I will never eat meat again, and I will never even drink milk again. So that's not quite my area. My area is trying to move things on gradually. I think we start by getting a decent House of Commons where things are properly debated. And then it's an iterative process. Then we can bring things in which would bring about more decency. I could go on, but does that kind of Yeah. It's a long road. You know, I do believe that we abuse animals, and I don't think we have the right to do that. So I would love to see that change, and actually that is why I'm standing here. Human beings do a lot of great things. They make science, they discover the universe, they make music, which is a wonderful kind of communication. To me, all the art forms are the higher things that we do. They're very worthwhile. We're not just here to exist. We're here to do something, and I think art is a great thing. So I love to make music. I will never stop making music. But for me, it's time to try and do more as a human being and try and raise our hand, try and make us a decent, compassionate society. You got a guitar?
Yeah, and a Sharpie.
Who does this mean?
Being academic,
I've
musical,
and
do you think it's important to school education to value music and
like
creating subjects as much as they value academics?
I do. I think it's a good question. I think you know, I can see that is happening here. In the school that I was brought up in, rock music was regarded as the work of the devil. You might think I'm exaggerating, but we used to have to sort of hide behind the cycle sheds to play guitars. It was really frowned upon because music, you know, really was regarded as something unhealthy and revolutionary, whatever, you know, rock and roll. In a sense, I was really lucky to be brought up in those times because it was the time when rock and roll was exploding, you know, from Bill Haley and Buddy Holly and the Crickets and Elvis and the Everly Brothers or whatever. You know, we were around at that time and we were just agog. It was like the world was exploding and it was our world. So I think you're really lucky to be in an institution which recognises that art of all kinds is important as a way of expressing ourselves as human beings. And I think we are, in a sense, on that bridge still. I think there's further to go, but at least we've crossed a major part of that bridge towards realising that every part of our brain is actually worth nurturing. So I'm with you. Yeah, please.
I'm really, really pleased you said that. It's one of the things I feel really passionately about, not only about this institution, Palmer's, but Thurrock generally. The fact that we need to be growing what they call the cultural and creative industries. But we know what that means. That means using your imagination to earn money, whether that's about creating your own job. Because basically, Ryan created his own job. He didn't go and apply. You didn't have to apply, did you, to be a member of the Queen?
No, there was no interview for him. We did interview some bass players.
Oh, you interviewed, yeah, exactly. So there's a little bit of that. But basically, you can create your own job, and that's one of the things that's amazing about cultural and creative industries. But start there and remember that your imagination is limitless, and that actually means your potential is limitless. And there are far too many people that tell young people to stop. You can't do that. You've got to go somewhere else. And we've got to find more and more paths through so that we can find a way that you can fulfil not only your ambition, right, which is probably to be another rock legend like Brian or whatever, but also to be able to make ends meet in the meantime. Because there's loads and loads of different steps. And I'm sure you can tell lots of stories about what it was like before you made it big. And actually sometimes when you're talking about fulfilling your dreams, a lot of it is actually just eating Mama and toast, not being able to afford anything else. And actually what we've got to do is make sure that while it's tough, you know what the next step is, and you don't have to worry that somebody's just going to say, no, sorry, that's not possible for you. I just want to say that it's really good. Well, like
and it's that thing of belief as well. Like if somebody says no, you go, actually, yes. Because I believe in what I'm doing. And that's a significant part of making your way in the world.
And they are being cheeky enough, so I think you should find out.
Oh, certainly, yeah. I think we should ask Polly some more questions.
Oh, okay, then. Gentleman in the white t-shirt in the middle. One of the things we've got to do is make sure that the paths from where you start, when you start thinking, you know what people, when people say, oh, what do you want to be? Actually, mostly they ask you, grown-ups ask you that thing, when you don't know. And they sort of want some sort of big, straightforward answer, so they can just put you on the right rail to where they think you want to be. And actually, life's not like that. It's actually much more sort of messy and difficult. and that makes it difficult for you to navigate that. So we need to be able to make those paths clearer. One of them is making sure that every time you get a qualification, it's not a filter to stop 80% of you getting any further. Instead, it's a pathway to saying, actually, I'm quite good at that. You might, like you say, you're quite good at creative stuff, but you don't know whether you want to make, you don't know whether you're going to end up doing it for your whole life. But you want to hold on to it, because it might be useful somewhere else. One of the reasons why I can stand up here and do this is because I spent 15 years as a journalist, but before that, it's because I did drama. I'm not going to be an actress. I realised that a long time ago. It wasn't good enough. But what I did teach me was I wasn't frightened of standing up in front of hundreds of people and saying something. And that meant that I was able to do lots of other things. I've been a journalist, so I have been on the telly, I've been on the radio, I've stood up and I've taught people, all of those things, and I didn't know I wanted to do any of those things. I thought I wanted to, you know, I wanted to do a little bit of that showbiz and glamour. Actually, I wasn't good enough. But I was good enough at taking those skills and taking them somewhere else. And that, everyone's got that, whether that is being able to, like, create the greatest riff of all time, you might have that, or it might just be, actually, I go home on a Friday night, and I change into my clothes, and I go out and I do my band, I play my band. And that fulfills me. And that's really important too. So we need to make sure there are apprenticeships, we need to make sure that qualifications don't stop people doing things, they enable them to do things, and that people aren't told that something isn't valuable just because it doesn't earn you money. And it goes back to what Brian says, we need to be able to make ends meet. There's nothing funny about living in a garret and eating Marmite on toast, right? That's really, really rubbish. One of the things that helped me was there was an enterprise allowance scheme. I was on the dole, and the enterprise allowance scheme allowed me to set up my own business so that I could start earning a little bit of money doing the things that I thought I was good at. And that stopped me, A, from having to sign on, which is literally the most depressing thing in the world. So please don't do it if you don't have to. But find a way out. And that was one of my ways out. And I want us, when we're in government, fingers crossed, May the 8th, to be able to enable you guys, if you do find yourselves unemployed, that starting your own business is an option. That's what I want to do.
I agree with a lot of that, but I'd just like to add, there is an element of risk in life, and you take that on board. And I was very poor for a very long time, and I actually didn't care. Yeah, I did have, it wasn't Marmite on toast, it was cod in a bag for me. You know, we had one little thing, and I shared a room about the size of this little area here with my girlfriend at the time. You know, and I didn't care, I was totally happy, because I had a vision and I believed in what I was trying to do. So it may not happen all at once. But you may go for the safe option. That's a decision you make. You can go for something safe, or you can take a risk. And if you believe in yourself as a drama, for instance, you can go for it. And my advice to people would be, don't take small steps. Take a big step. Because if you fall down, you can get up and take a big step somewhere else. Don't sit there thinking, oh, I don't think I can move, and I'll just move a little bit over here because I'll be safe. My advice would be to take the big step. Go for what your dream is. And then see what happens, because your dream may change. But go for what's in your heart. That would be my advice.
This is such an ambitious community, and that's really lovely to hear these questions, because I know there's so much ambition and excitement here. So we've got to be able to channel that, because I think people are finding it tougher than it should be. So that's
always tough, isn't it? It's tough. It's a
it's
tough
world. Tough.
And
well,
if people tell you that, you know, I think.
No, I was just going to say.
Go on then.
Can I just say it's really difficult interrupting a rock god, okay? But I would like to be a Member of Parliament, so it's probably in my job description. The reason why I would say we can, one of the things that politics can do is to ease those risks, is to make sure that some of those big risks are less big, and therefore don't end up with people being trapped in where they are because they can't take that big step. I know there's so many people here, for example, will have had older brothers and sisters who had the education maintenance allowance, which just covered a little bit of the cost of getting to college, the travel costs, the books and that kind of thing, and now they don't have that. Now, actually, in this community, there are a lot of families where that's basically the difference between whether you stay on and get a decent education or whether you don't. And that's the kind of thing we need to be able to change. And that's why I'm here, because I actually believe we achieve more together than we do alone. If you're on your own, you can end up stuck in that garret and nothing, and you've only got yourself. And I think sometimes there isn't, because society benefits from us being good at fulfilling our own ambitions. And that's why society has an obligation to the next generation to support them to fulfill those dreams.
I don't know what I was going to say anyway.
Oh no.
Carry on.
Next question.
So I'd just like to talk about a scenario. We've got, say for instance, around here, we've got a lot of colleges, sixth forms, academies popping up everywhere. All of them want to keep hold of like students because of the funding. So say for instance, one college wants to keep three of their best musicians. We want to keep, you know, as many musicians as we can to run the course, and somewhere else wants to keep three musicians. But with three in a course, there's no way you can run it because of the funding. So eventually what will happen is nowhere will run music. I want to know, as a music teacher who hopefully runs an okay course. Thank you so much.
Yes, you've done.
Yeah, lovely. Thank you. Yeah, like, you know, I feel we strive for the same things, employability skills, musicianship skills, all of those things to propel people onto higher grounds, you know, exactly the same. But how's that going to work with the current funding and the idea that I might have three students next year so the course doesn't run, even though we do it exactly the same thing, you know, what can you, so I'd like to hear your views on that really.
My view is that if you've got that kind of situation, it's a really good example of how competition between educational institutions fails people. It fails you as a teacher, it fails the next generation of talented musicians, and it fails our society because those people are not able to get the kind of education they need. So I would be looking forward to a situation where our educational colleges and schools and whatever can collaborate, because I'd much rather have one really, really, really good music course that was available and was able to be delivered because we had enough people doing it, than each of them withering on the vine because they don't have enough kids in their class. Now that I know is hard because of the funding settlement and the way the funding works, but that goes back to what Brian was saying. You actually have to spend quite a lot of time in politics, going through lots and lots and lots of really, really boring bits of paper to work out how to change the funding settlement from the way it works now to a way that will work again, that will work better. But the way you do it ends up being in the detail. The way you understand what the answer needs to be is by having conversations like the one we're having now. Because I can then go and talk to our education team and say, this is rubbish. We've got amazing kids, right? And we're at the risk of our music courses dying because they can only get three or four on a course because we've got this ridiculous competition for funding per head. What are we going to do about it? It's one of the reasons why I think we should have a technical university here in Thurrock, right up to degree level, where you can learn vocational qualifications, which could well include music and performing arts. We've already got the creative industries developing their degrees here. Can you imagine what it would be like? So you could earn for a little bit, learn for a little bit, go in and out up to degree level, and have those radio production skills, those music production skills, and studio production, but recognise that needs to go right up to that level. Unless we have that level of ambition, so many kids will be failed, and this ends up being individual failures, which you feel rubbish about. Do you know what? We all feel rubbish about it, because we all lose out every time somebody's talent is stymied by an education system that filters people out rather than being a springboard to opportunity. So I'll listen to what you say. We should have further conversations about that funding. Is that all right?
Yeah, thank you.
What made you want to take science at pre-level?
What made me want to take science? I suppose curiosity, just a love of it. I was inspired by Patrick Moore when I was a kid. I used to beg to be allowed to stay up to 10 o'clock to watch him on the TV, and he was bringing the universe to us for the first time. And I was just enthralled. I wanted to know more about the universe, and I still do. I still find it fascinating. So although I went off for 30 years and did other things,
That's a bit of an understatement, isn't it? I'm a bit busy being a rock star.
I was busy, but you know, there's a thing in my heart which thought, you know, this is unfinished business and I want to go back. And actually it was Patrick Moore who became a friend, like an uncle to me. And he said, Brian, you could go back and you could do your PhD. So I got the offer from the head of physics at Imperial College where I started, and he says, you can come back. So something I said. And so I did, you know, I got my PhD, and it, to me it's still thrilling and inspiring. I want to know about the universe. Are you an artist or a scientist or both, I hope?
I want to go take
mathematics. Maths, yeah. I actually love maths. Because it teaches me about the universe. It teaches me how the universe works. I love maths and I love the pictures that go with it. And I taught maths for a year at a secondary modern school in Brixton, which at the time was a rough place to be because most of the students had knives. but it was also very inspiring. Some of the kids that I taught, you know, I still meet, and they go, "Oh, you were that you? Hello, sir. You know, you were that guy who persuaded us to stay an extra year and do maths. So good luck to you with your maths. It's great."
The lady in the white top. This is both of you. Who is your
Ooh. Shall I go first?
Yeah, go first.
First that comes to mind is Isaac Asimov. Anybody know Isaac Asimov?
The Complete Robot.
To me, he wrote one of the greatest trilogies ever written. It's called, it's three books called Foundation, is the first one. Foundation and Empire is the second one, and Second Foundation is the third. It's colossal. It's the biggest thing you could ever read. It's the complete history of the universe from the year dot until way in the future, and you will never ever guess what happens in book three. It's incredible. And before I die, I'm going to read it again. Foundation by Isaac Asimov. That would be my choice.
If I was going to talk about one that inspires me, it's Margaret Atwood. Oh, I've got some fans. That's good. My favourite Margaret Atwood book is The Handmaid's Tale, and I was thinking about it because of Brian mentioning Isaac Asimov. Because actually, in a way, The Handmaid's Tale is science fiction in that it's set in the future, but every rule in that world where women are contained by what they wear, what they eat, where they can walk, who they have sex with and so forth, are based on rules that have already previously existed or currently exist somewhere in the world. And that level of oppression, all put into one book, really, really, really makes you think how far we have come, but how much further we have to go if we want to have proper equality. And that's just about women. When you think about it, there are other things that she has done which has challenged other kind of prejudices we have and really make you think very strongly about what we need to do about changing the rules so that we can treat people equally and not oppress them and limit their abilities and their talents.
I do agree with that. I'm agreeing, really. I'm saying, you know, equality is something which bothers me greatly. It kind of stops me going to sleep at night. You know, the more you realise what's actually going on in this world, the more you realise inequality is rife. Even in a supposedly civilised country like ours, you know, equality of opportunity does not exist.
No.
And it should, in my opinion. You know, why should somebody have a different different level of opportunity just because they're born into a rich family? It should not be that way. Everyone should have the same opportunity to fulfill their dreams. And that's what we're about in Common Decency. And I know that you and your colleagues are very much about that as well. We need that in this world.
Gentleman there in the black.
Hi, this is Brian. Obviously, you know, you've been one of the biggest fans in the world in the doctor and astrophysics and what have you. Have you ever considered being like a music teacher? Teaching
I've done a little bit of teaching privately, but I've never considered. I mean, I was a teacher, as I taught maths for a while, and I loved it. Whether my life will let me do that anymore, I don't know. Maybe I could do a little bit of it, but there's too many things in my life, in a sense. I have too many passions, so it would be hard to just be a teacher. You know, that's why also I didn't want to stand for Parliament. I would find it hard to just do that. It would stop me making music. It would stop me doing astronomy, stereoscopy, all the things that I love. And also at my time of life, I'm starting to think, you know, I have children who are pretty much grown up. I now have grandchildren. I want to spend some time with them. So partitioning your life, time management, becomes more of an issue as you grow older rather than less. So I don't think I would ever be a full-time teacher, but I wouldn't mind doing a bit.
I think we've got time for a few more questions, and they've all come up. Shall we take three at a time? Will that help? So we can get through more. We'll take the blonde guy at the back, the lady with the glasses, and the guy in the blue shirt at the back, you three first. And can you holler? Because we need to hear you.
What was it like to work with Freddie Mercury?
I bet you never get that one. I can't answer that one. Lady with the glasses?
What would you say the music that inspired you to become part of Queen was?
Say that again?
What music inspired you to become part of Queen?
What was the music that inspired you to become part of Queen? And guy at the back with the blue shirt?
Do you think musicians should make an attempt to be more political, like get a political message across more than they do now?
Okay, this is me, isn't it?
Yeah, that's me.
I'm fine with that. Freddie was amazing, unusual, ambitious, uncompromising, and not a people pleaser. He didn't do things because other people expected it. He did it because he wanted to. He was focused, and I would recommend that he be the same. That's the great lesson I learned from Freddie. Why did I become inspired? It was the rock and roll thing with me, you know. My parents grew up on Johnny Ray and big bands and stuff, which was very nice. The crooners, Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, all fantastic stuff. But suddenly there's people screaming in anguish and anger, like Little Richard and, you know, Elvis to an extent. You know, to me that was inspiring. I wanted to be part of that, and I still want to be part of that. I love music which exposes the soul and the passion. And what was your last question?
Whether musicians should be more political. Because you had like Red Wedge in the 80s, and that doesn't seem to be around anymore. That's all about passion for marketing.
I would like to see more musicians more involved, I suppose. Yeah. Strange enough, I just made contact with Paloma Faith, who I didn't realise was so into it, you know. And she's had Owen Jones on tour with her, coming on and giving talks, which I think is amazing. So actually, I'm going to meet her for the first time tonight in person, so I'm really looking forward to that. Now, she is passionate, she is into it. And I'm going to really enjoy that. You like Paloma Faith? Yeah. So there are people, you know. And I would like to see more of it, yeah. But of course, you know, people, while they're in the middle, she's at the early stages of her career. She's got a long way to go. So she still has to concentrate on building her career and making her music. That's fair enough. And I really admire her so early in her career for taking such a stand in a political sense. So yeah, bring it on. I would like to see more of it.
It's good that you mentioned Red Wedge. We've got some people who organised Red Wedge coming to organise an event here in Thurrock on the 30th of April. It'll be held at South Essex College between 1 and 3 in the afternoon, and we're going to have local artists, young people from Thurrock, performing there. So if you want to come along, that would be a great opportunity. If you want to perform, get in touch with us afterwards, because we're building the programme as we speak. That's exactly what we want to talk about. We have so much talent in this community. We need to be making sure that that talent is shaping the kind of future we want to have, and that's why we're doing it. So, lady with the glasses again. Sorry, man in the Levi's t-shirt.
Do I have any say in this?
Oh, sorry. I'm going to pretend to be the speaker. Would you like to choose?
One
more round of questions. You better choose then. Go on.
You go first, go on. make it one.
I feel mean.
I've got a guy down here.
Okay, the guy down there. Right, so those four. Lady with the glasses first.
What advice would you give to someone who's battling lectures between academic subjects and creative subjects? Because it's always so
difficult
to choose between one or the other.
Mm. Okay. Should we just...
I can't do this business of asking four questions at once. It makes no sense to me.
Okay, go on then. You're in charge.
Am I?
Yeah.
I said, well, I'm here to support you. So, this is the truth. It's a hard one. You know, I think, you know, in this world, we should not really be made to choose between art and science, for instance. You know, I think we should all have the chance to do it all. But you've got to do one thing at a time, in a sense. So I would repeat what I said, you know, take a big step towards something which you have a passion for, especially if a door opens. Be ready for those doors to open, because they may not open ever again. Go through it, see what it's like, and then later on you think, okay, well, maybe that wasn't right, and you can go someplace else. But go for your opportunities. You worked for them, take them. Much about to play beside. Interesting. There's a whole lot, really. I wish I'd got the chance to play with John Lennon. I would have loved that. People play arena. I like a lot of the younger people that I played with. Like I played with Foo Fighters a couple of times. I love those guys. So when they have that passion and elemental energy and fantastic musicianship as well, I love them. My Chemical Romance was a great moment. And I'm sad that they split up, you know. They should have asked me, rule number one is don't split up. Because you have something precious and it may never come back. But anyway, yeah, that's probably enough.
My question is, obviously you're very passionate about like creative arts and like physical music and such. What is your take on communities, local communities, for people who want to do more technological stuff? Like, really, I was trying to apply to West London music and sound recording. What's your sort of, like, what's your community, local community, like, what is your just like funded or such?
Yeah, you're sitting there with your phones on, you see, you know, this guy carries his studio around with him. Well, things have changed a lot. You know, you used to have to go into a big studio to do something and pay lots of money. It's really not like that anymore. You can do most of the stuff you want to do in your home, can't you? So I'm not sure what the future of sort of studios are, as a sense. I think it's great to have, I mean, I've visited a few music colleges and there are lovely rooms with lots of equipment in so people can play. It's like toys, isn't it? You know, I love that, you know, people should have the opportunity. But on the whole, I think it will still happen privately. I think you'll get inspired, you'll do your thing, and you go, okay, this is what I'm doing. You build your little studio in your bedroom. If it does well, you build a bigger one in your living room. You know, and then if it gets better, you'll get promises. You know, like Polly was saying, you know, you're making a job for yourself, in a sense. You're creating around you. And not for money. I don't think you're probably going to be doing it for money. You're going to be doing it because you love it, and you're creating something. And that feels good. God, it feels good to create something. So, good luck to you. I forgot you, I'm so sorry.
That's right.
You may not be able to get your parents to support you. You know, I think you have to take that on board. That's part of growing up. You know, you have to, in a sense, make your own place in the world. You may not get parental approval. And I think you have to take that on board. And if you believe enough in yourself, you will still do it. And if you're lucky, like I was, you'll come to a point where your dad or your mum goes, okay, I get it now. And then I think we all do want parental approval. We all want to break away and kind of reject our parents' values. I think that's part of growing up. That's the bird leaving the nest. You know, you have to fly on your own. But in the end, it's nice if you can get your parents' approval. And your parents will approve if they realise that you're doing the best thing for you. Because all parents want the best thing for their kids. They just worry that they're going to go off the rails or something. Take drugs or something. You don't want to take drugs. Nobody is going to take drugs. So, you know, don't do it. Do the good stuff. Do the good stuff.
It's okay, moving swiftly on. So, you're wearing the super dry t-shirt, lady in the red, and with the sunglasses on you.
With Labour aiming to raise the minimum wage to £8, how do you think that will affect small businesses in the UK? Because my dad, who I work for, has a small business, and I broke my ankle a few weeks back, and I couldn't work because he couldn't afford payment for not working and not getting a job. So, how do you feel that will affect the small business?
I'm so glad this is you.
We introduced the minimum wage, and when we introduced the minimum wage, people said it would be a job destroyer, and it wasn't. Finally, people who have been paid £1.50, £2.50 an hour were being paid something that was a floor on how much people could be paid. Because otherwise, what you have is people working longer for less, with less security. Now, I know and understand how important it and how difficult it can be for people in small businesses, but that's why we have the Low Pay Commission, in order to be able to have that deal and work it out with businesses and with them, and with academics and with the trade unions and so forth, to work out what that amount should be. Now, we've got an ambition to make it £8 an hour as soon as possible, because it's actually been stagnant for a long time and it hasn't been raised, and that's a pretty good example of why we've got these stagnant wages. You say prices rise, wages stay the same, and you'll have heard it from your mums and dads, even if you're not experiencing it yourself. Hang on, why is there so much month at the end of the money? That's not good, and that's as much for people who have still got, who are employed, as it is for businesses. So we need to get that fairer. I also would say that we will give tax breaks to companies who pay the living wage, which is more than the minimum wage, because I think responsible businesses, which I'm sure your dads would be, would value being rewarded for doing the right thing by their staff. It also means those staff are more likely to hang around, and that's good for retention, for loyalty, and for developing your business. So those are some of the things we do.
Thank you.
Lady in red.
It's okay, I can think of one. Living in Thurrock, one of our big issues, and I love it, anything happens on the Wooden Bridge or the M25, there's a big launch. Coming into Lakeside, it can take up to an hour to go to get to Lakeside, it's a long journey. More and more houses are being built.
Yeah, we've got a real infrastructure problem in this community, and what I'm worried about is that infrastructure problem will become worse if we get another crossing that comes through without the rest of it being able to be built up to meet it. Now, in some ways, having a traffic jam, I know this is going to sound weird because it's really annoying for all of us who live here, but having a traffic jam around a massive great big thing like Lakeside is what some economists would see as a high quality problem. It means people have got money to spend, and they're going there to spend it, and they're coming to our community to spend it. But we need to see more of that money staying here, making sure that as they grow, they put money in to developing the roads and the traffic calming measures and so forth we need, so that you're not locked into Ockenden on a Saturday afternoon, because I've been there, so I know exactly what you mean. And that means things like the Junction 30 and 31, proper remodelling, not just having a bit of a tweak around, which is what they've got at the moment. It will need big stuff. And I'll say to you about the crossing, we've said that we will put all options on the table, including option D, because it shouldn't be in Thurrock. They've basically decided it should be in Thurrock without having any conversations with us. And that's what, if there's one thing I would say about Brian's project on common decency, I would like to contribute to the common decency project, is politics has got to be something that is done with people, not to people. For far too long... that has been overlooked, and things are just done to us. And they won't worry, they won't complain. Yes, we bloody well will, right? And instead of us having to complain, why don't we have a constructive conversation? So have conversations with us. We're reasonable, practical-minded people in this community. We're happy to find some solutions, but we can't do them. We can't find those solutions if you decide to wrap it all up beforehand and then tell us it's already decided. That's why we need to have those proper conversations about the crossing. That's why we need to have proper conversations with London about some of the impacts of their decisions on us. And that's why you need somebody who's going to really stand up for Thurrock and has got the kind of leadership that can have those conversations without simply moaning from the sidelines. Thank you.
So thank you very much to Brian May.
Thanks for having us. It's been great.
Thank you very much.